Again, I'm Bev York, and I'm a volunteer and member here at the Windham Historical Society. Today, our program is What the Jillsons Ate in 1825. 1825 is the year of the house. William Jillson, when he moved here, he and his brothers were in their 30s. He already had a career. He was already the president of a bank in Cumberland, Rhode Island. But because cotton was going to be such a big deal, these brothers decided that they would come here, purchase some of the water rights, and build the first factory, which was directly across the street. They owned the property and some of the buildings of the what became Willimantic Thread before Willimantic Thread. And so this is a mill owner's house. And so he is not going to be, even though he's already wealthy when they move here, and he and his wife have five children, two live from infancy. These are still the days when most people lost half of their children to childhood diseases. Yeah. And so, unfortunately, they only had two children living here, and we don't know, we historians, trying to be more accurate all the time, we actually don't know whether or not they would have had a servant girl. They may have. And a lot of times in those days, immigrants or orphans become servant girls for families who are well-to-do. And so we're going to talk about what the Jillsons ate. You are sitting in their kitchen. You will notice this beautiful stone house, that this kitchen is a little wing off of the main part of the house, which is very common in those days because when we heat the fireplace, we don't want to heat up the rest of the house. So the next room next to us is the dining room. And as you enter the front door, though most of us entered the back door today, which, so you're all family. we entered the back door today. The front door is open, but when you come in, so usually one room is the parlor, the living room, and the other room is the dining area. And then this would be the kitchen. So not knowing whether or not they had a servant girl of any kind, Mrs. Jillson may have done her own cooking most of the time. So in 1825, it's still a fireplace. So 1820s and 1830s, this is the time if you've been to Sturbridge Village, if you've been to Mystic Seaport, they are still cooking on the fireplace. We're still actually eating pretty much they did all through the colonial era of the 1700s. After this time period, very soon, because there are heating stoves already, the Franklin stove has already been around for 50 years. So people are installing into their fireplaces cast iron stoves for heating, and no doubt putting the teapot right on top of that now.
They call them belly stoves, right? They call them belly stove?
A belly stove.
They may have, that's could be, and they've had all kinds of names, actually. The Franklin stove is invented by Benjamin Franklin. And then, of course, within the next generation or two, people will have a large cast iron stove for cooking. So those big black cast iron stoves that would have been all in the Victorian houses up on the hill that were just before that. One of the things about this fireplace is that it is smaller than most. A lot of cooking fireplaces in the 1700s and early 1800s are much larger than this. And but they also knew with those large fireplaces that they were losing a lot of heat. So this is a rather small and modest fireplace. And so I'm going to talk about a little bit about what they ate first, what kinds of foods they had, and then we'll talk about all the implements and how it was cooked. If you're going to have bread and cheese on your butter and cheese on your bread, I need some volunteers. So I'm going to pass this around. I can see the back row is anxious, but what we need is
there's not a back row.
You are the back row. So
only this week?
Well, yeah. So it's
I'm gonna hold it somewhere.
You might want to be able to hold it in your lap.
Sure.
But I would, try to hold it by both handles or by the bottom. And you just up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down.
I want butter on my bread.
Okay? This is generally why, what children's jobs, unfortunately we don't have any children here today. I thought we might. And this is a cheese mixture. And so we'll start off talking about dairy. In the 1820s, we still don't have any refrigeration. So we'll start this one in the back row. Oh, you put your hands right up like you were ready. So give it a couple stirs and then pass it. The back row, we need to really mix that cheese mixture up.
We had a lot of help in this kitchen, didn't we?
We're the children.
We're the children. Okay, pass that back to Lou. She'll take it.
Oh, she will.
I'm Lou.
Bless you.
Everybody can have a chance. Keep passing it around. Okay, so in the early 1800s, we still don't have refrigeration. We think of, they had ice houses and the ice man went around. This is not yet. This is still coming. There are places that do have ice houses, but I think that they would have been wealthier places than this. In the 1820s, Willimantic is a very tiny little mill village. Windham Center is really the main part of town, Windham Center Green. And I think if to have an ice house where they cut the blocks of ice off the ponds in the winter, they probably would have had those in larger areas, outside of Boston and Philadelphia, and really large cities or larger towns, Wethersfield, Hartford, Norwich, New London. But as far as I know, it would be too early to have ice houses. So we can't keep our milk, so we have to make it into cheese and butter. And now, of course, a lot of the buildings that were behind here would have been built later than this. We have no idea how big the Jillsons' property would have been at that time and whether or not they had animals. But most everybody did, except that he's a mill owner. So how wealthy are they? So we don't have all the answers at this time. Okay, so what are we eating for meats? At this time, by the early 1800s here in New England, we pretty much hunted out most of the wild animals. So occasionally we would still have some wild animals, but basically at this time. Trouble already in the back row. I knew it.
Thank you. No follow. He didn't see it, so no follow.
The
it's just two spots. I'll wipe it off.
So the meats that we're going to eat are going to be mostly domestic. So people are going to keep cows, maybe not the Jillsons, but somebody. Cows and pigs and chickens and even sheep. We'd still have sheep in Connecticut in the early 1800s in large quantity. And they're going to eat a lot of fish. So whether they're still fishing out of the river, they may be, but they're also building dams. So what they're doing is they're ending the opportunity for those shad to come up the river. And I assume as soon as they start dumping a lot of their dyes in the river, that they know that not to drink it, not to eat those fish. But one of the things that's still really, really popular is seafood or fresh fish from
your turn.
Fresh fish from the rivers. And they are eating, one of the most popular things to eat is oysters. We know this because in the old cookbooks, and they did have cookbooks here in Connecticut and here in early New England and from the 1700s and the 1800s, and the cookbooks are filled with recipes for oysters. So there's a clue. Another thing, a document that we have here in Windham is that the early fire department, the first fire department in Windham, starts in 1825. It's in Windham Center. In fact, they have their original pumper. It's one of the things that they own. And according to the minutes of the records of this volunteer fire department, if you were late, if you were late to the weekly meeting, this is before everybody even had a watch, if you were late, you had to pay a nickel fee.
Really?
And then all of that money was collected because the annual picnic was an oyster festival. So there's something that, a document that tells us that it must have been a really special thing and they must have loved their oysters.
Where did they get them from?
They get them from the shore. So they'd probably go to Norwich or New London. Probably could get a lot of seafood in Norwich. Yep. Yes.
Can I say something? I don't mean never, but we're talking about oysters, which is true, because I used to do a lot of bottle digging and stuff. We go out in the woods, beautiful, and you always find a whole bunch of clams, the old shells, yeah.
Yep, so oysters and mussels and clam shells, all very popular. Okay, so that's pretty much what they ate for meats. Now, still without refrigeration, a lot of these things are going to be dried. Some of them are going to be pickled. And a lot of it they're going to try to eat fresh. Even in the 1700s, they did co-op sharing of their meats. So let's say I live in a farm in Windham, and we need to butcher our cow. We're going to do it in the middle of winter, because that's one way we preserve our meat, is it's frozen in the barn in January. And then I'm going to share with all of my neighbors a quarter of this cow. So everybody gets a quarter of the cow. Then next winter, it's your turn. You're going to butcher your cow, and we're going to share. So there was a lot of cooperatives, meat sharing, in Connecticut in the late 18th and early 19th century. All right, fruits and vegetables. We are still in the time when we're going to eat most things in season. And so for fruits, the number one fruit is apples. And so they ate a lot of apples. They ate apple everything. Apple cake, apple sauce, apple pie, apple bread. The number one drink is cider. Even in the early 1800s, most people here in Connecticut are not drinking the water. When they came here, when the settlers in the 1600s and 1700s, because you don't drink the water in Europe, the water in Europe was already polluted.
Yeah.
And so when they came here, they were not used to drinking water without boiling it. So they would boil their water for tea and, of course, for cooking and for coffee, but they wouldn't just drink water. So what did they drink cold? It was cider. And a lot of it was hard cider. It would go bad. And that was popular.
I know. Tell me about hard cider.
Yep. So they would eat berries in season. So June is strawberries and July is blueberries. And then they would have pumpkins and squash. And they would be able to dry some of these things as well as make preserves and also to make them into wine. One of the things I'm thinking, driving down here, seeing some dandelions, and I said, this is when they would have been making dandelion wine. They ate a lot of dandelions and other plants that are outside that they would know which ones to eat. And they were really actually very interested in eating those green plants because they have just gone a whole winter without eating anything green.
Yeah. How about flowers?
They didn't really understand vitamins. They didn't really, even in the early 1800s, we still don't know sanitation, we still don't know vitamins, we still don't know germs.
Yeah.
That's way after the Civil War that we're getting to that. But we do know that, oh my goodness, I haven't had anything green and I kind of am craving it. So their bodies actually crave things that they were interested in. Yes?
About flowers. Like violets, I had somebody made me a beautiful salad, marigold, stuff that we, and that one with the end, and that, when they, that one.
Yes, you can put marigolds and violets in salads, so they knew which flowers to eat. A lot of the ways that they learned in the 18th century what they can eat here or not is from the natives. That's how they learned it.
Well, dandelions had a good big pot. You don't realize that.
So, you got to pass it around and take another turn there, Amy. All right, great. The vegetables. Now, they would have kept a vegetable garden, I'm pretty sure. Almost every house did, except generally some lawyers and doctors and professional people, if they didn't have families, They probably didn't garden, and they probably didn't chop their own firewood. But by and large, most families would have done a little firewood and a little gardening, and that's one of the things that children are for, and women. That's one of the things that women were for. The gardens that they grew were mostly what we know today, they called the keeper vegetables. So where were they from?
Well, the potatoes look like Maine.
No, I'm talking about Connecticut.
Well, okay, Connecticut, well.
They're all rooted vegetables.
They're all roots. They're all roots. So
oh, yeah,
carrots,
okay, right, right.
Carrots and onions and beets and potatoes.
White carrots?
Radishes,
probably.
Rutabagas. These are all roots.
Yeah.
And one of the things about these plants is that you can grow them in your garden, and you can actually leave them in there after frost, and you can eat these for months. So you can put carrots in your refrigerator, and they might be a little rubbery, but you can still survive on those, you know, months later. So they grew vegetables to keep. They did not grow things like a lot of lettuce and a lot of tomatoes and a lot of things that are rotten in a week. Yeah. Why would you do that?
Yeah.
Because you're still living in an era when you need to grow things that are going to get you through the winter.
Many people thought tomatoes were poisonous.
Yeah.
I just read a document written by Thomas Jefferson who said that he has started eating tomatoes. And he also is one of the first persons in the country to have ice cream. So for years I've been talking about, well, they didn't have ice cream. Well, if you were rich enough, if you were one of the richest people in Virginia, you already had a nice house, like I said, some places did. And, you know, you did have ice year-round. So, but here in Willimantic, even in 1825, even a mill owner, it's still more rustic than some of these other places where extremely rich people live. Okay, so we've talked about fruits and vegetables, and now let's talk about grains. In early 1800s, we're still eating the same grains here in New England that we had in the 1700s. Number one grain is corn. It's being ground into cornmeal. The next thing that we have is we grow a lot of oats, and not so much wheat. What's happening here in Connecticut is wheat, it's a little bit too far north for wheat. So they didn't grow too much wheat. But in the 1800s, actually a lot of the farmers, what's gonna happen here is the farming land is going to be, the nutrients will be used up, and a lot of people are gonna start hearing about these great farmlands west, and people will begin to move west. This happens a little bit more in the 1840s and 50s and 60s, but it's just the beginning of that. Some of the grains, one of the grains that they grew, of course, was a lot of corn.
Right.
And this is some of the corn that they grew. And they also grew a lot of beans or legumes. And some of the beans that they grew in the 1700s and 1800s, they're called Jacob's cattle beans. And so they look a little bit like, they look like a red cow with white or black spots, look
really?
A little bit like a cow.
Yeah.
And those are some of the old plants that they grew. Now, these kinds of crops actually take a lot of land, so they are not growing these here. They are buying their grains in the store. So they're probably buying cornmeal, and they're probably buying oatmeal, and they're probably buying maybe some wheat that came from somewhere else. At the local store. Okay, so let's see. We did meats and dairy and fruits and vegetables and grains. What I'm thinking is that it's not a farm, but it's a property where they would have had a garden with some vegetables and maybe some strawberries or some fruits and definitely some herbs, because herbs are medicinal as well as tea. But you wouldn't be having an acre of corn. Because we're already in a city. Now, it's a small mill district, but it's gonna very soon be a city. Because as these mills grow, and in the next 30 years, in a generation, Willimantic is gonna be a city. If you're local and you know the city, up near Stop and Shop and Friendly's, there was a farm there, and it was the Fitch Farm, and that was a 300-acre farm.
Wow.
And eventually it got sold off. The Fitch house is actually, was in bad condition, but the Sturbridge Village bought it, and in 1954, it was the first building that they acquired.
Right.
And Sturbridge Village, it is the printer's house. It's right on the green. And so there would have been large farms around here. And I'm thinking that when William Jillson built this house right here in the town, that that he's not going to have crops. He didn't buy a farm. Yeah. He bought a lot, and he's building his mill. So he and his brothers are building mills. So they are buying their grains, I'm sure, from the store.
Now, how about the last house on Quarry Street, the last farmhouse? Where I lived.
There was a farm on Quarry Street till when I was
there. And I wanted to say, chicory. Yeah. You know, you see that up on Mayfield, where they use for coffee. That blue wild plant, it was a coffee type of
stuff. Imitation coffee, right. So sugars, what did they use for sugars? So the natural sugars here in Connecticut are, what are they?
Maple.
They can use beets for sugar too.
Yep. Yeah, honey and maple syrup are what we've been using. And also, for people of wealth, and the Jillsons would have been, you would have imported sugar.
Oh.
So some sugar comes as brown rock sugar, and so it's coming from the West Indies, and it's made into a cake, and so it's kind of hard. It's like a giant sugar cube, and it's wrapped in paper, and then some of them were cones. Now, this is a cone that I got from Williamsburg several years ago, and the top part is broken off. What I say about these sugar cones is that you could buy larger ones if you were people of wealth. So I'm fairly certain that probably at some point the Jillsons had rather large sugar cones. Now, these sugar cones, they used nippers, they used iron nippers, or even silver nippers to nip off pieces of sugar and put it into your tea. So Mrs. Jillson in her dining room would be having guests for tea, and so they would have had either a sugar cone, or they would have had, you could probably buy sugar in different forms at that time, depending on how much money you wanted to spend. So at the in the early 1800s, we have a mix then of our natural sugars and of imported sugars that you're buying at the store. Another thing that you're doing to flavor your foods is you're buying spices. So you would buy cinnamon and nutmeg and grate them up to use for spices. So when you're doing your baking, and this is just like in the 1700s, because as I said, much hadn't changed by 1825, to serve things for your fine guests, you would serve imported foods. So if you could get macaroons that have coconut, or if you could get a pineapple, maybe you are aware that the pineapple is a symbol of welcome in New England. And it's not because we grow pineapples, it's because if you could purchase a pineapple and put that on the table for your guests, that was like the piece de resistance, the best thing you could possibly do. So macaroons would have been for entertaining because it's not something you ate every day. Of course, the everyday fare were things like molasses cookies, gingerbread cookies. These are basically they're butter, sugar, some sort of flour, and some spices. So common fare is your gingerbreads. For entertaining, you would serve macaroons, you would serve pineapple, lemonade, something with lemons. They did a lot of baking. They did a lot of baking because they're living in a house without heat. Okay, so when we're in here in the winter, we also freeze. So that, even with the furnace, that hasn't changed much. But we don't have central heat until about the 1870s. About these 1870s and 80s in Willimantic is the time we're going to get all of those wonderful luxuries. We're going to have heat. We're going to have telephones. We're going to have indoor plumbing. So we still don't have indoor plumbing here. I mean, we do. There's something in the basement. But what I'm saying is the Jillsons would not have had indoor plumbing. Still would have been using an outhouse. And so, hi, come on in and have a seat. So, the we don't have heat, so therefore, living in a house without heat and living in a lifestyle without heat, we can eat a lot more sugar and a lot more fat than we do today. So that's the story on the baking. Now, they did have recipe books, receipt books, they sometimes call them, but they also memorized recipes. And if you're making something that you're making the same thing over and over every week, you can memorize a recipe. A recipe for brown bread is 1 cup of sweet milk, 1 cup of sour, 1 cup of molasses, 1 cup of flour, 1 teaspoon of soda, molasses, 1 cup, I think I messed it up. Bake, steam for 3 hours and eat it all up. And then it goes on to say, and you need 1 teaspoon of salt, but does not, but it doesn't rhyme. That's the whole poem. So there were some recipes that they would commit to memory, I think. Okay, so now let's talk about some of these implements and some of the, and cooking on the fire. Things that we have here. In the 1800s, most people are eating from metal and crockery containers and dishes. Yes?
When you make the butter, did they add a little bit of sugar into the butter to make it sweet?
They might have, but they would definitely add salt because that's what's going to keep it. What's happening is the cream is going to turn into two things. It's going to turn into butter and buttermilk. And we have to pour off the buttermilk. Okay? We're going to eat off of dishes, we're going to eat off of crockery, and we're going to still eat off of metal because we don't know that all of these pewter things that we have contain lead. And the Jillsons probably had fine china, and they probably had even some silver platters and silver service,
right, right,
because they would have been wealthy enough to have really fine things. So in the 1700s, we're eating off of wooden plates that we make here in New England. In the 1800s, we're eating off of metal. I'm sorry, the 1600s, we're eating off of wood. 1700s, we're eating off of wood, metal, and crockery, same as in the 1800s, adding to that fine dishes and silver. Okay, so tea. Tea is very, very important. Now, what we did in the, for the American Revolution is we dumped a lot of that English tea into the Boston Harbor, as you remember. And we started drinking coffee. And Thomas Jefferson said, coffee is the perfect drink. The perfect drink for America. So now people drink both tea and coffee. But what we did after the revolution is we boycotted British goods and we started making herbal teas. We called them victory teas. So in their herb gardens, people were growing things like mint, like chamomile, like lemon. And out of all of these wonderful herbs, they're brewing teas. Some of them are medicinal, and some of them are just good tea. So what they're doing with these teas is they're heating up their water. The teas are dried, you dry the leaves, you crumble up the leaves into so it's pieces, and then you put those right into the teapot. And so now we have the hot water, the boiling water with the tea in it, and it's poured into the teacup. And on the teacup, I'll use this for a teacup, is the strainer. So we're straining the tea leaves out of the from the teapot as the water goes into the teacup. So no doubt they would have had a fine tea service for serving tea. Yep.
Wow, that's a little one like that.
Now, this crock, this has cinnamon in it. But they would have had all size crocks to keep their foods in. So after I've gone to the market and I bought some oats and I bought some flour and maybe I bought some brown sugar or molasses, I will bring those home and I will put them in my crocks. And I, so they would have all sizes. I have a lot of different ones, but I try to pack light instead of bringing my entire kitchen down here because we do have a lot of beautiful things here.
I don't want to go to your house. You don't want to come to mine either.
So they had a lot of simple implements, but as the Industrial Revolution progresses, they will have a lot more gimmicks and gadgets for their kitchen. But they did have a few things. They did have apple corers. But when we come back and do another cooking demonstration and it's 1870, I have some apple peelers that will knock your socks off.
Yeah.
So one day they were having an apple pie supper at the church and they said, well, we need people to come for 4 hours to peel apples on Saturday. And I said, no, I'll do them all in a half hour. They looked at me like I was from out of space. But with my apple peeler, I can peel an apple in 10 seconds. So please use the other door.
I brought the pizza.
Okay, can you take it to the other door too, also, please?
Okay.
Thank you so much.
So you're connected?
Okay, so let's talk about cooking on the fireplace now. So what we have here is, this is an 1825 fireplace, and it has a crane. This is the crane, which comes out. And this is really great because now I can serve my foods right out of this pot. And I can make this, the crane, provide high, medium, and low. So the way that we do that is the height at which we hang our pots. If we use these, the letter is S.
That's what S hooks.
Yep. So if I hang the pots down really low, now this is high.
That was awesome.
Oh wow!
High.
That's awesome.
Oil.
Yeah.
Now I want it to simmer. I'm just going to bring it back up, and I'm going to hang it up here, and it's simmering. So the height at which you hang your pots. Now, the major food of early America is soup and bread. That's your major food, soup and bread. Soup and bread. So some days they ate soup and bread, and some days they ate stew and bread, or chowder and bread, or bread and stew, or bread and chowder. How you doing? Doing great.
Fantastic.
This is what people ate. We often think that it took people forever to cook. That's not true. It took people forever to make textiles. 75% of women's waking lifetime before the industrial age is producing clothing and bedding for the family.
Wow.
The other 25%, you're raising children, caring for the sick, cooking, doing a little gardening, and drinking a lot of tea, I guess. All right. Peas porridge hot, peas porridge cold, peas porridge in the pot 9 days old.
Oh.
So you have no refrigeration. So you have soup going on and you have cornbread or oat bread and you have that all the time. Now, so you're, whether it's your poor family or your middle class, they didn't really use that term then, your family that is an average farm family, or whether you're wealthy, you still are eating a lot of soups and breads. What we're going to add to that for a wealthy family is they're going to have more variety. They have more variety if they have people to grow those foods, or if they have servants to do cooking, or if they have money to buy whatever they want. Okay? Because I'm pretty sure that George Washington and Thomas Jefferson ate whatever they want. Okay? But they're not here. Okay, so we're going to have our soup, and then we're going to be, so you're using the crane to cook with. Now, this term is usually called hearth cooking, and what that means is that we're cooking things on the hearth. So sometimes we're going to take some of the coals, we're going to shovel them out, make a pile of coals right on the hearth, and put some kind of pans that are actually footed right on those coals. Now, right now, here's a trivet that has feet on it. So if I put this on the coals and I put one of my dishes on that, then I would be able to turn it around, but it's going to be warm. It might even cook because it's on the coals. So some of the cooking is done on the hearth by putting coals there.
This all looks rather dangerous.
It's hugely dangerous.
I was going to say, you get a lot of burns, I imagine, the wild blood.
Okay, so here's the deal with the fire. People have been cooking over a fire, over a live fire, until 1870, since the beginning of mankind. There it is. That's how they heated their water. That's how they did for washing and washed their clothes. All of that is over a fire. And that's your warmth also. And ask Abraham Lincoln, that's your light. So it is, it's rather dangerous.
So you could close and you could spill the coals on your feet.
We are wearing 100% wool. So wool doesn't really burn easily. So that's part of it. Actually, I'm glad you brought that up, because right now there's this big cotton boom going on in America. We're going to start wearing cotton in the summer because it's cooler. And when we do, cotton will be more flammable. But in the old New England, we're wearing wool year-round. Okay, so we're loving it in the winter, but we're not real happy in the summer. But we're also Puritans, so we're very modest. In the 1800s, in the days of the Jillsons, the style is now a federal style of clothing. It's a high empire waist, the dresses, with large sleeves. The dress that I have of that style no longer fits. I'm just going to leave that right there. If I were doing an earlier demonstration or a later demonstration, I have colonial and Victorian
you
dresses.
You should have washed it in hot water. I told you it was shrink.
So, so anyway.
Well, with that long, that lemon, but not that really neighbors have a long sleeve when you're cooking.
Right, yes. Well, so, but they would have aprons, and they also wore caps because of the snow, because of the smoke and the ashes and the dust.
That's why they were really bright.
Still at this time, we're still wearing caps in the house. We're wearing bonnets to go out, and we're going to wear hats right up until the 1960s, and that's when Americans stopped wearing hats.
Really? That far up?
Wow.
Pretty much. Well, that's when men stopped wearing hats, too.
Yeah. But my name means hat.
John F. Kennedy did not wear a hat at his inauguration, and that killed the hat business in America. Ask the people of Danbury. Everybody got laid off in the 1960s. That was the end of hats. Prior to that, and I remember growing up in the 40s and 50s, and still people wore a hat every week to Sunday school.
Oh, yeah.
What about inside the house?
Inside the house.
Hats.
We're wearing a cap inside the house because it keeps our hair clean. We still don't have plumbing. Did you miss that part of the lecture? Okay. We still don't. We don't have a toilet and we don't have a bathtub. Now they have a bathtub in the White House, and we have to heat up water. We can soak our feet, and we're doing a sponge bath. And some mill towns, of course, this isn't a thriving mill town yet in 1825. Another 50 years. Some mill towns actually had bathhouses where you would pay and go and pay for a bath, kind of like a Roman, bath.
Right.
We don't know actually that Willimantic had a bathhouse, but I think they might have, because there are so many mill
towns. I believe they had a boarding house, my grandmother.
Oh, there were many boarding houses, yep.
What about men's hats inside? Would they wear a hat inside?
Probably not, unless they were cold. So, okay, so a few more things I want to share with you. One is a tin oven. This is a tin oven or a reflector oven. Okay, so now we've talked about the common foods that we're going to eat. We're going to eat cornmeal or oatmeal for breakfast. We're going to eat soup and bread for lunch, and soup. Lunch is actually dinner. It's the bigger meal. We eat the biggest meal in the middle of the day because of our work. And at night before we go to sleep, we eat a smaller meal. Actually, dietitians are saying that's what we should be doing today.
Right.
The bigger meal should earlier in the day. So, but now we're talking about, and soup and bread. Now let's talk about, we're a mill owner. So we're going to actually be able to have roast turkey. We're going to have roast beef. We're going to put some meat right on this. We're going to put it in this tin reflector oven, which would have been very shiny and reflective inside. And we're going to place this right up against the fire. And that's going to cook.
Now, can I ask you something, Bev? Mm-hmm. Maybe sounds stupid, man, to you, but actually it was handy. But when did they come out with one where they rotated?
You would rotate it every few minutes, and that would be children's work.
But I mean, after they come out with automatically, we have the rotation.
Well, there are some that I've seen in museums that actually the dog would run and it would rotate, or there's one that's like a clock and it gets going and it has some kind of weight to it, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, yeah.
And it actually does that. But those are for the extremely rich.
Okay.
The ordinary person is somebody's turning that crank.
That is really cool. So
the Jillsons would, let's talk about how long it takes to cook these things. Boiling over a fire takes just as the same amount of time if you have a good fire as your stove. Baking in a reflector oven or baking something on the hearth takes twice as long as your stove. Baking bread in this oven. So when we bake bread in here, we're actually going to build an entire fire in this oven. We're going to fill it with a lot of wood, and it's going to burn down. It's going to take about 2 hours to totally burn into ashes. Now we can do one of two things. We can leave the ashes in there and just set our food among the ashes, or we can use an oven broom, wet that, because so it won't burn, sweep out the ashes. So there were different ways of cooking. Some people were neater than others, just like today. And they didn't even have this kind of tin oven for bread baking yet, but they will soon. So let's say I have a round of bread. So we build a fire in here, we let it burn down. Now we take our lumps, our rounds of bread dough, and place them in here on the hot bricks. And we take cakes and pies, a lot of them would be in crockery, and we place them in here. We might want to place that on a trivet on the coals. And then we place a door on this, and this is going to bake in the same amount of time as your oven.
Really?
So the fireplace and the bake oven takes about the same amount of time. Cornbread is 15 to 20 minutes. The underneath part is for wood storage. Sometimes they're called ash pits to store ashes. Ashes are valuable. Ashes are going to be used to make soap. And even you can pay your school taxes in ashes. Don't we wish we could do that today?
I never heard that one before.
So, yep, ashes have value. So in my study of fireplaces, that's really, it was just an extra space. It probably was very warm. Some people may have used it to raise their bread dough. So there's a number of different scenarios on the ash pit, as they call it. Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about, as the Jillsons were mill owners, and as they had their wealth, they would be buying more and more implements, more and more implements, things that ordinary families wouldn't have. And one of those would be a waffle iron.
How cool is that?
Now, if I'm a farm family with 10 people to feed, I'm not making waffles. I'm not even making pancakes because it takes too much time and they need to be watched constantly so they don't burn. But now, if I have a servant girl or if I have enough daughters or if I just have an opportunity to have something really special, is I would have a waffle iron. And the waffle iron, I'm going to preheat it and grease it just like you would today. I'm going to put in the batter. I'm going to stick it here in the coals. In about a minute, I'm going to flip it over. And then in about another minute, we're going to have the gorgeous golden waffle. So there's lots of things that we do. And actually, cooking on the fireplaces, people do a lot of that when they go camping.
Yeah.
It's exactly the same idea. That pretty much completes some of my talk. Questions? Do you have any questions?
What are we making this for?
Okay, we're making this because in just a minute we're going to put these up here. And I have some pieces of bread, and you'll be able to try the butter that you just made and this cheese mixture. And because this is the common snack. In fact, the main snack for children in those days was bread and cheese. They could even have it warm like a grilled cheese sandwich. It's interesting because today, what do kids eat? Grilled cheese and macaroni and cheese?
Right.
Well, we never heard of macaroni, but we made a lot of grilled cheese. Actually, I'm going to take that back. I'm going to end with, we did hear of macaroni. Macaroni in those days had a totally different meaning. Macaroni meant a good-looking man. We have a couple macaronis in this room right now. So, in the song, Okay, Yankee Doodle went to town riding on a pony. Stuck a feather in his hat and called it macaroni. It's really interesting that this is our Connecticut State song, because that song is actually a British drinking song. They are making fun of the American soldiers. So they're calling us doodles, which means simpleton, silly person, and stuck a feather in his hat. And the second verse talks about the really thick cereal when you take the cornmeal and you mix it up. Father and I went down to camp along with Captain Gooding. There we saw the men and boys as thick as hasty pudding.